I'm Sumesh. I'm basically a researcher and a campaigner on sustainable tourism. Now I'm also an entrepreneur as well. So basically, I've been working on tourism for last 20 years. All these years, I've been getting a question, why tourism? And definitely in order to answer that question, I have to go back 20 years ago, where I was working in Bangalore. So I was also attracted to a movement which was against, protesting against a rayons factory in Calicut. This particular factory was polluting a river and environment, which was also causing a lot of cancer death in that region. So of course, I was also part of that protest with a couple of my friends. And definitely, that gave me an opportunity to interact with people like fisherfolk, Adivasis, and farmers. And all these interactions and dialogues and conversations gave me a new understanding of their priorities and their learnings and their expectations. So which gave me a different perspective on development as well. That's exactly my entry point to the development sector. And since then, I've been working in development sector with a special emphasis on tourism and development. So this is what you see usually in terms of tourism and development. But at the same time, when it comes to reality or when you go to destinations where real tourism activities are taking place, if you talk to the local communities, you can also get the dark side of tourism. Like, for example, this slide shows that tourism is a resource-intensive business. Like, it's a very thirsty business. Like, for example, a local residents living in destination, they use 14 liters of water per day, according to UN. But when it comes to tourism, a hotel guest is using 1,785 liters of water a day. This is just one slide. And if you consider the carbon emission and other factors tourism is, in terms of resource utilization is really huge. And definitely it's also causing a lot of problems like water pollution. Our little backwater areas are, a classical example of how tourism is affecting water bodies and all. Like, for example, a proud product of Kerala tourism, houseboats are very largely polluting backwaters today. And tourism is also one of the industry which is largely displacing people. I mean, when I say displacement, it is both direct and indirect. Some cases, big hotel and tourism projects like special tourism zones are directly displacing people. And also load of indirect displacement. Like, for example, if you consider the post-tsunami cost, Tamil Nadu and Kerala, lot of real estate activities took place and that indirectly displaced communities from the coast. Like, for example, again, I'm coming back to Alappi. Some studies says that in the Alappi coast, 70%, nearly 70% of the land already, the fishing community already lost. So you can just imagine that is creating other issues like social issues and certain extent how it impact their livelihood and all. Of course, privacy is a big issue in tourism. Like, if you go to, again, backwater areas and all, we did several studies that, and people say that they can't do anything because whatever they do, they are being photographed. Like, whether they take bath, washing vessels, like if you go to these backwater areas, 70 to 80% people are still depending upon all this water for their daily life. So this is what is happening in the name of tourism. And definitely, the real question in front of us, who really benefits from tourism and who bear the cost? And of course, if you take Wayanad, I'm basically from Wayanad. If you take Wayanad, 60% of the Wayanad population is, depending upon agriculture or allied activities. And nearly 18% of our population is Adivasis, so-called indigenous communities. And what is their role in current tourism in Wayanad? That's a really interesting question, especially in the context of tourism and development. These all are the larger questions which we need to answer. And of course, all these involvement, years of involvements with these people and dialogues and conversations with them led to us a question, how to define tourism from a community perspective and what is their expectations? People like Adivasis or fisherfolk or farmers living in destinations, and what is their expectations in tourism and how to meet that expectations, or whether we can meet that expectations. And all these questions, came to us. And we had a lot of dialogues with all these communities. And finally, we reached in a point that, we need to form a kind of a collective group. And that's exactly my organization I'm working with for last 12, 13 years. And of course, when we started our program, the obvious question in front of us was participation of local communities in tourism. I mean, still we are working on it. So we call it participation challenge. Still, it is a challenge in many ways. I'll explain to you. Basically, when I say community participation in tourism, in most of the cases, which is misinterpreted or misunderstood concept, in many cases, like even many of the tourism programs, local participation in tourism is defined as menial jobs or low-paid jobs, like sweeping and things like that. So many hotels, like if you really analyze the industry, you can see that they claim that they are bringing local community participation in tourism, but that's not sufficient. And also in many NGO projects, sometimes that is also reality. Participation is basically a token participation. So, and many of these schemes are voluntary schemes. There is no legitimacy according to the law. So these are the challenges which we face when we talk about participation in tourism. I'm sure in another development aspect also, the same issues are very common. So when I say participation, especially when we talk about grassroots, what does it mean? I mean, what participation mean? So we came up with four levels of participation challenges, which is inevitable in order to make tourism more sustainable. The participation number one, participation in decision making and governance. So people should get a forum to take decisions on their own life and livelihood. That's very important. And second thing, definitely participation in business, not just menial jobs. Meaningful participation in tourism business, something like entrepreneurship development and other benefits. And the third aspect is participation in management, which is a very much discussed topics for last 2-3 years, because all over the world, destination management is a challenge. Even if traditional sending countries like Barcelona, Berlin, or European cities, they are also facing a lot of protest against tourism. Even probably the last 2 years ago, there was a mayor election in Barcelona. The basis of mayor's election was her anti-protest, tourism protest background. So this is a very tricky issue now. So participation in managing tourism, including destination management, is a key issue. The fourth one is very important, especially when you take tourism as a development model, monitoring tourism. Whether tourism is beneficial or detrimental to the local community, when you talk about development, it's not just economic benefits. Other benefits are also important. So how to monitor tourism with local community participation is a multi-billion dollar question. So in our program, we are trying a little humble attempts. All the villages, we are working in many states, all the villages we are working, we are trying to facilitate local communities, facilitation committees in destinations. Like for example, the chairperson of the committee is basically people elected representative, like panchayat president or panchayat member, which is giving a legitimacy to the company, a committee according to the Panchayati Raj Act. So the other members, like women representative, youth representative, even representative of Adivasis, and all part of the committee. So basically, they are trying to ensure these four levels of participation in tourism and other village development activities in all these villages. So basically, all the programs which we are trying to promote in our village, it's authentic. We don't recreate any activities. So travelers getting an authentic travel experiences when they visit us, definitely, which is experiential. And when you talk about market, this is a very rapidly growing market segment. So we get considerable market share also now. Of course, it is slowly changing from its status of niche market to the mainstream market. So when I say community participation, definitely, which is also giving a very competitive tourism products. So that's also an advantage. And definitely, all these projects are community owned and which is also contributing to the larger community development. Definitely, we are also working with people like women auto rickshaw drivers, rural women in general, and we sometimes they work as storytellers, sometimes they also work as other entrepreneurs in tourism. So there are many interesting programs which we develop with women in general in many parts of the country, and sometimes outside of the country also. And I would also like to mention one project which we are doing in the post-flood situation in Wayanad. Basically, there is a village called Tekkundara, which is in Wayanad. This village is one of the most affected village during the flood. You can see that the devastation happened in the village. Many farmers lost their crops like coffee, paddy, and so on. So now we started working with them. And what we did actually, we started a program, facilitated a program called Nam Anbode. So, which is basically bringing Adivasis, farmers, consumers, and travelers together to this particular village. So what we did actually, we found 100 travelers and consumers, and we are all kind of contributed to some money to the farmers and doing joint farming. Particularly rice farming, especially rice completely lost during the flood. So it's an interesting program because farmers are getting initial investment without interest. So it's really interesting. And for them, definitely it's a value addition because they are also doing farming in a traditional way. And also it's all organic. And when it comes to customers, they are getting rice, organic rice, quality rice, little less than market price. So it's a kind of a win-win situation. It's not a charity. Both farmers and consumers are getting benefit out of it. And also a very good travel experience for travelers who are coming to the village. And of course, this also provided employment for people like Adivasis, especially immediately after the flood. The employment situation was very difficult in Wayanad. So that also gave them a livelihood opportunity. And now what we did actually, we also developed farmers' homestays like other places, which is also giving an additional income to the farmers who are, part of the program. And another interesting aspect, what's happening in all these villages, many of the farmers, they want to shift to chemical farming to organic farming. The biggest challenge in front of them during this, transition period, there is a huge income loss. So, but at what we are trying to do in this particular village, taking tourism as an interim arrangement to cover the income loss during this transition period. So that is also happening in these villages. And definitely we have a lot of women interpreters in these villages and many other entrepreneurs like taxi drivers and so on. And definitely, we are also now expanding this to other crops like coffee, pepper, and now we are discussing about packaging of all these products and different marketing systems and all. So this is also a new development. So definitely, I already mentioned that all these agriculture activities are considered as a kind of a traveler's experience. Many travelers are part of all these efforts. Both, they invested also, and also they're coming to stay in the village and they're experiencing the real village life and, agriculture. So this become a very, experiential travel product of Wayanad today. So, you can see that lot of activities. And we are also now working with potters in the village because now pottery is also not doing really well due to several reasons. Now we are trying to work with them in order to conduct workshop for travelers and also. This is a kind of an additional income for the potters as well. And this is what people say is on us. And she's really interesting. She's probably one of the oldest women auto rickshaw driver probably in Kerala, Jeffreya. She is now conducting tours for travelers in Calicut. So we organize different tours like this. And of course, many farmers, they took this homestay program as a interim or additional income program during the agrarian crisis. And you all know Wayanad agrarian crisis was very well known after Vidarbha. Wayanad was the place where most of the farmers committed suicide in India. So definitely this kind of a program helps farmers to get an additional income. And of course, he's a very young farmer. He's also diversifying his income, like auto rickshaw. Sometimes he's also working as storyteller. So this program also giving them an additional income. And this is another interesting program which is near Kayamkulam. In a post tsunami coast, seven women, they formed a self-help groups and they built a solar eco-friendly cottage, and they're running this business. So we helped them with our training, and also we are now marketing the program. So definitely training program is one of the most integral part of our organization. I mean, in financial terms, I would say last year something like 25-26% of our total budget allocation is for training. So when I say training, we have a complete training module for homestays, rural women. We have a module for storytellers, like communication, you know, presentation and so on. And also drivers, youth, and villagers in general. Like I already mentioned, the village committee, they're also getting a training on various aspects, like how to monitor tourism and all. And definitely our training modules are also covering larger aspects of environment, like zero waste and so on. So the training helps us to really set up these programs in villages. Thank you.